Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit. Bandwidth for Triangulation is brought to you by CashFly at CACHEFLY.com.
This is Triangulation, episode 241, recorded Monday, March 14th, Pi Day 2016. Sprint! Triangulation is brought to you by Audible.com. To download a free audiobook of your choice, go to audiblepodcast.com/triangulation. And by PillPack, a full-service online pharmacy that combines modern technology, convenient packaging, and personalized service to make your life easier. Visit PillPack.com/twit to save $20 on vitamins and OTCs when you transfer your prescriptions over. And by DigitalOcean, simple and fast cloud hosting built for developers. Deploy an SSD cloud server in under a minute. Try it today for free at DigitalOcean.com. And once you sign up, be sure to enter the promo code Triangulation in the billing section to get your $10 credit. It's time for Triangulation, the show where we get together with some of the most interesting people in technology. And I don't know about you, but I consider it my learning hour each week where I really get some big ideas stuffed into my little brain. And this one's a good one. This one, I think, is a technique that you can use, that everybody can use, to be more effective and more productive, particularly startups. And it comes from Jake Knapp. He's our guest today, the author of a new book. Hi, Jake. Welcome.
Hey, thanks for having me.
TheSprintBook.com. This is Sprint. First of all, we should mention that you're a partner in Google Ventures. Is that right, Jake?
Yeah, that's right.
And although you may remember him from such things as Google Hangouts and the Priority Inbox and things like that. You've worked at Google for 10 years, right?
Gosh, close. I never thought of it that way.
Yikes.
Very close. I kind of think of Google Ventures as a separate time, but
right.
Yeah, if you lump it all together, it's like nine years.
It's all Alphabet, baby.
That's right.
This is a technology or a technique that you and your co-authors, and I should give John Zaratsky and Braden Coetz credit as well, developed at Google, particularly to work with the startups that you work with at Google Ventures for getting from idea to a first product in 5 days.
Yeah, well, for getting to a test anyway, to test a prototype. So it's a process that I first started at Google and used on what was a very early version of Hangouts and very early versions of Priority Inbox when working on Gmail. And then we refined it at Google Ventures while working with startups. So the idea is that you can move from some big question or big idea or big challenge at the beginning of the week, clear your schedule and go through the steps. By the end of the week, you'll have a realistic prototype and you'll test it with 5 customers.
I'm going to be honest with you, Jake. This is I feel exhausted just thinking about it.
I know how it sounds.
I'm so tired already.
It is I won't lie to you. It's a full week.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
It's not a crazy week.
Well, wait a minute. Now, before you say that, I should point out that 3 days of those 5, you have no access to either your phone or your computer.
That's right. Which is like a spa. I mean,
you call it a spa. I call it withdrawal. I call it DTs, baby. It must have been hard to get some of the people you work with to do that.
Yeah, well, the thing that we do in the sprint is, you know, you're not meant to use your phone or your laptop while you're in the room. And this is true for the first 3 days, but you can leave the room at any time. So if you want to check something, there's no judgment.
Oh, you get to pee. That's good.
If you're right, you know, whatever you're doing, that's up to you. But we. But what we found is that usually people, like, at first it's good, they like to know that, but people actually rarely end up doing that.
They rarely
step out of the room. Part of the reason is we don't work long hours in the sprint. We know that you're going to tire out if you spend burning the midnight oil every day.
Right.
So it's like we start at 10, we end at 5, we take an hour for lunch, and we're very focused during that time. But the the point is not to burn people out, not to run crazy. It's just to make good use of our time.
Actually, and I'm being, of course, I'm being silly because I read this and I found it very fascinating. I have done Agile. This is not the sprint that you might know from Agile.
Right. It's definitely works with Agile.
It seems similar in some ways.
Yeah. I mean, it's a week, you know, and that's something that people who are familiar with Agile will be very comfortable with, the idea of you know, blocking things off into weeks or longer chunks. And so this is something that can work with Agile. You might start with one of our sprints. If you're doing a longer project, you might switch back into regular Agile mode. But it's not the exact same thing by any means.
So just to, I've kind of leapt into the middle of this, and we're going to step back and start at the beginning. Yeah. But just to give you some idea of the provenance of this, Jake, of course, has done these sprints. We mentioned Gmail and we mentioned Hangouts, but he's used this process with 23andMe, Susan Wojcicki. He's used it with Slack, with Nest, with Foundation Medicine. John Zaratsky, his co-author, was a design lead at YouTube, an early employee at FeedBurner. And Braden Kowitz has worked with many Google products, including Gmail apps, Google Spreadsheets, and Google Trends. So this is not some, you know, laboratory idea. This is not some test tube idea. This is tested in the furnace of the real world. It has been for years. So it's a really interesting methodology, and we're going to get to it. I want to start, though, a little bit with Google, because one of the things that it always impresses me with Google, and I think it goes right back to Larry and Sergey in the very earliest days, and I remember having lunch with them in, you know, like, the first year, and being so impressed with them, is that from day one, I think they didn't want to make it a traditional company, and realize that one of the real challenges as you grow a company from a little lean startup, a little graduate student project into a big company, is keeping innovation and movement forward, not getting bogged down in the syrup of bureaucracy. And they seem to have done a good job of that. What do you think the key DNA is there?
Well, when I came to Google, I had been interested for a number of years in personal productivity. I had been working at Microsoft, and I had been trying to optimize my own time as much as possible ever since my oldest son was born. And I kind of realized that, you know, if I was at work, I was missing time with him, and I wanted to make the days count. And when I came to Google, what was really remarkable to me was the way that people embraced experimentation. And so the ideas that I had about personal productivity, I realized could be applied to maybe the way teams worked, that I could experiment with my team and even with, you know, getting other teams to try new things. And people were open to it.
That's one of the things that's great about Google, is they really, they seem to give you a lot of autonomy, but also kind of an openness to new ways of doing things, right?
Yeah. And there's definitely a feeling that, you know, if you can, you know, if you can prove it to us, we'll give you a shot to try it. And that's, I mean, this process, this book wouldn't exist if that attitude hadn't just been so pervasive at the company. And it was really exciting for me, and kind of led me on the journey that ended up in the sprint process.
What did you do at Microsoft?
I actually worked on Microsoft Encarta. So,
whoa!
I know, that's...
Dude!
Yeah, I was actually with my son not long ago at a technology museum in Seattle.
It's in the museum, baby.
It was in the museum. And he saw the box and he was like, Dad, look, it's
you're in the museum.
Did you work on this? And I was like, man, I don't know if that's cool or not cool. But I worked mostly on Microsoft Encarta. I also worked on some hardware projects that never turned into anything. They were sort of incubation projects.
Can you contrast how it is at Google versus how it was? And I should say was, because I think Microsoft's process has changed 180 degrees.
And this is a long time ago, so I don't want to, you know, draw too many comparisons that might not be accurate anymore. But one thing that I think actually people don't give Microsoft enough credit for was having great designers. And in those days, I had Microsoft Encarta.
Oh, it's beautiful.
Yeah, it was great. It was a great team. Bill Flora, who went on to do the Metro design that, you know,
uh-huh. a lot of people also beautiful.
Yeah, it was was the, you know, sort of the original design lead on Encarta and developed that sort of language and, you know, mentored me. I had other great design mentors while I was there.
So I should explain. Kids, there used to be something called an encyclopedia. And you'd get it. And I have one on my shelf, a world book, 26 volumes. And right after I bought the world book, CD-ROMs became very popular.
And Microsoft, you should explain what a CD-ROM is because...
I should. Oh, kids, before there was the internet, there was a disc you would get that would have like this 650 megabytes worth of stuff on it.
Yeah.
That was enough to put an encyclopedia...
Right? We say ship it now, and in those days, you really ship it.
You actually put it in a box. Encarta was awesome. Actually, there it is. That's a Britannica.
Yeah.
Encarta was started with kind of a funky... almost literally funky encyclopedia that Microsoft polished and polished until it really was probably one of the top CD-ROMs out there. It was amazing.
You know, I really miss Encarta having kids now because Wikipedia is amazing, but there was a sort of a craftsmanship to some of the articles that in Encarta that you can't really find now. And
was there ever an effort to put that online? Or
there was, and I think there, you know, well, let's just say I don't think that the strategy that was adopted turned out to be the right strategy.
Because Encarta was taking the print encyclopedia and giving it rich media, and that's where design really made a big difference. There was video, there were lovely images. It was really beautiful. I just went to the Encarta page on Microsoft UK, and this is what I got.
Oh, so, yeah. That looks like that's this all is my years of work is just that.
Microsoft.com/UK/Encarta. The design, though, you cannot fault the design. It's
clean. It's so clean. Swiss.
So that's interesting. So there was a sense, and it's funny because Steve Jobs is famous for saying to Bill Gates, "Well, you have no taste." but in fact, you know, when you think about things like Encarta, that was taste. It was beautiful. It was gorgeous.
Yeah. So anyway, you know, I mean, there were great things going on at Microsoft. Yeah.
How about process though?
The process was different. I mean, there were a lot more product managers at Microsoft than there were at Google. There were a lot more designers actually at Microsoft than Google. When I came to Google, there was only a handful of us.
Well, that's true. Google was not famous for design, was it?
No, I mean, I think Google is even in those days, Google was very good at the kind of design that, you know, that I think matters, which is making products that fit people. That
load
is
fast,
design.
Get it done. Yeah. Don't get in the way. Yeah, that's exactly. A kind of design, isn't it?
Yeah, and so the kind of design that I found myself doing at Google was really exciting to me, but you had to move so fast, and there was no, and those, this is old days, and this is 2007, there was no sense of, you know, make it beautiful, or make it, you know, the only elegance was in the way that the software actually behaved, and in the way that it solved problems for you.
So you come from a traditional graphic design background?
I actually studied painting in school, but I'm a long time computer nerd. So all of my design is learned on the job, and that's at Oakley before Microsoft. So Oakley, the sunglasses company.
Oh, and
at Google, and then with, you know, at Google Ventures, also
did
working.
Did you work on those Oakley glasses that had the MP3 player built in the?
No, I don't even think there. In the days when I worked at Oakley,
there weren't MP3s.
MP3s, yeah,
there were no
MP3s. It would have been like an LP or something.
But Oakley's glasses always look so cool. They always are.
Oh,
you know,
man.
Well,
they had the ones when I worked there. The big thing was the ones that went over the top of your head.
Okay.
That was really something.
That was designed for design's sake, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Because Microsoft has that reputation of being kind of burdened with middle management. But that's kind of a natural thing when you're thinking about building an organization. You think about structure and hierarchy, and you report, the team reports to the product manager, the project manager reports to the, and it goes all the way up, and you have this elaborate hierarchy. What are the negatives of that?
Well, in any kind of large organization, and I mean, I think this kind of comes back to why we sprint. Is this true? Because this is true of startups, and I've really had the chance to work intimately with the smallest companies, and then also like the largest companies, and they share common problems. If you have a new idea or you have some big thing that you're working on, people will always end up having a lot of abstract discussions, you know, in conference rooms, trying to figure out is this the thing we should do? Is that the thing we should do? Who do we need to get to agree before we do it?
And it's like nailing Jell-O to a tree.
Yeah. And at startups, it's not so hard to figure out who you talk to.
Right.
When the company's small, there's not so many people. So that's the added thing that comes with larger companies, is getting the right people in the room and starting to think about politics. But the fundamental underlying problem is just trying to guess what people are going to do when your product is out there, trying to guess which is the right thing.
Oh, isn't that interesting? Yeah.
And so, so in the sprint, what we try to do is cut that abstract conversation down and say, look, we're going to follow a process to lay the solutions out. We're going to make them as equal as we can. When we put them on the table, we'll choose, we'll prototype, we'll get some data, and we'll do it so fast that it's not worth arguing. It's not worth, waving our hands. We'll find out on Friday. And that's the kind of thing that, from my experience, will benefit the biggest company or the smallest company, because everybody struggles with it.
Well, we're going to get down to it in just a second. We're talking with Jake Knapp. He's the author of Sprint, How to Solve Big Problems and Test New Ideas in Just 5 Days. This just came out a few days ago. It's pure methodology. I mean, you read it, it goes day one, day two, day three, and it is really interesting. It is not the same sprint as in the Agile process, although it might share some interesting features. And it's tested, which is interesting. This comes out of Google Ventures, and you've worked with more than 200 startups to use this process to get to kind of a first prototype. So I think this is fascinating. We're going to take a break and come back with Jake. One of the things I should mention is our sponsor, audible.com, and how you can get a free book. And guess what? Lo and behold, I guess you could get Sprint as your free book at Audible.
You'd be crazy not to.
You'd be crazy not to. I love it. Audible has... I've been an Audible member since 2000. I love Audible. And one of the things I really appreciate is that Audible has done more than single-handedly than any other company in the world to bring the idea of audiobooks to the forefront. And at this point, here we are, 16 years since I started using Audible. Every new book, that comes out on Audible, which is great. So it's a book. Think of it as a bookstore with 180,000 back titles and all the new stuff, too. So when you go to audible.com and browse around, you'll see the Harry Potter books, but you'll also see, the latest from, your favorite thriller author or science fiction author. Look, there's Unbroken by Laura Hillebrand. That was such a great movie. Actually, I loved her other books. They have all, in fact, I listened to, which one was it? Secretariat, I think, or no, Seabiscuit, I mean, that's the one. Fascinating, wonderful. She is a great writer. And to hear her books read to you is to bring them to life. So you're there with Seabiscuit, from the first race to the last, and it's exciting and it's thrilling. You're seeing it in your head. That's what's so great about audiobooks.
It was the beginning of 5 uproarious years of anguish and exultation. From 1936 to 1940, Seabiscuit endured a remarkable run of bad fortune, conspiracy, and injury to establish himself as one of history's most extraordinary athletes.
It's a lovely book, and I highly recommend it, as well as Unbroken and as well as Sprint. So here's the problem. 180,000 titles. How do you get into it? And I know a lot of people think, well, I don't know. Could I listen to a book instead of reading it? Well, think about how much time you spend in the car each day on your commute or at the gym on the treadmill or washing dishes or walking the dog. All those days, all those times, all those hours when you can't hold a book, but you could be reading. And I know people get mad at me when I say reading, but it's reading. Every word's there. Every word written on the written page is there. It just comes to life in your head. It's somebody reading to you, and it's wonderful. So I know you want to say, well, can I try it without risk? Because I may not like it. I understand. Yes, you can. Go to audiblepodcast.com/triangulation. audiblepodcast.com/triangulation. And what we're going to do is you're going to sign up for the gold account. That's the book a month subscription. Subscriptions are the best way to use Audible. It's the most affordable way. And it's kind of fun when your subscription renews each month. Then you get to pick another book. But that first month is free. And you start listening to Sprint and you say, boy, I really wish I had the paperback or the hardcover rather of the book. Then you just cancel and you'll pay nothing. You get to keep the book you chose though. You also get the Daily Digest of the New York Times or the Wall Street Journal. That's part of your subscription. audiblepodcast.com/triangulation. You've heard us talk about it. Maybe you've been waiting for just the right book. sprint, how to solve big problems and test new ideas in just 5 days. This is nice. It's 6 hours and 10 minutes. You could literally finish this book in a week on your commute. Or, you know, you go on the treadmill every day for half an hour. Bingo. Bada bing, bada boom. A couple of weeks and you're done. Sprint. Then you'll be wondering, what's next? Audiblepodcast.com/triangulation. Give it a try. And we thank them so much for their support. They've been supporters of our podcast since the very beginning. I think we were the first. You hear them on all the podcasts now, and you see the ads everywhere. I see Audible ads on like big TV shows now. But we were the first to do Audible ads way back when. Jake Knapp is my guest. He is from Google Ventures, which is Google's venture capital arm. Ventures has nurtured and brought so many startups into the world. It is, I mean, if you can get an investment from Google Ventures, man, you got it. You do a little happy dance after you walk out of that office. The book Sprint, and by the way, it's not the money. It's stuff like this. It's the help.
It's the book. We'll give you a free book.
You get a free book. No, yeah. It's the support of people like Jake and John and Braden who are, you know, have done this many times, have been through this process, who can help you. You know, they talk about startup schools like Y Combinator. That's kind of what it is. You're kind of, you give them the support. And I know, you know, Kevin Rose, who's a long time good friend and worked at Google Ventures for, I don't know if he's still there. I think when he started Hodinkee, he kind of went off on his own. But also, you mentioned his partner, Daniel Burka, who helped him start Dig, is also mentioned in the book. It's a great idea. So let's start talking methodology here, Jake.
Yeah. You
mentioned that one of the traditions at Google is, okay, we'll let you try it, but you only have a certain amount of time. You tell the story of Priority Inbox. You were able to get a great engineer. What was her name from Google?
Yeah, Annie Chen.
Annie Chen.
Yeah, she's awesome.
And
yeah.
And she said to you, well, I'll give you 1 month. And if this doesn't work, I am out of here. I'm going off to another project at Google. That's one of the things that's cool about Google is you can do that.
Yeah. Yeah. People had a lot of autonomy, which was great if you had an idea and you could rally people to, right. to you. But I only had Annie's help for a month. So another engineer had this really cool idea for sorting email, you know, and I think it's something if you use Gmail or you use Inbox today from
I
Google.
Priority Inbox.
Yeah, it's really cool. And when this guy named Peter Balsiger came up with this idea, and he was just experimenting with it in his sort of 20% time, and it was promising, but he didn't, you know, we really needed to spend more energy on it to find out if it would work. And so I said, look, Annie, would you help us out? And she said, well, I'll give you 4 weeks and then we'll see. And if nothing comes of it, then I'm going to go on to the next thing. So that was actually a big moment for me, realizing what you could get done in a short period of time, because we hatched this plan to build a different version of Priority Inbox, of the, you know, basically the Inbox UI, every week for 4 weeks. And so each week
Whoa.
We would launch a new version to a few test users. And it was actually like, you know, Annie was sort of hacking their inbox so that it, you know, like sort of a little fork, so that their front end of their inbox was showing their real email sorted into, you know, some different UI structure. And each week we could get feedback from them. And that crazy pace forced us to make decisions fast. It forced us to not worry about every single detail, but get things just, you know, real enough, just good enough that we knew we were getting good data back. And by the end of the month, we had hit on something that worked, that people were, you know, interested in. And we'd made it real enough that it stuck as a real product. And so that was, you know, that made me kind of rethink a lot of the things I'd been doing up to that point for team process, which were kind of basically variations on like a group brainstorm. And I realized there's something so much more powerful when you make something real, when you test it. And what we needed to do was combine that sort of idea of we're dropping everything and working on this one project. And that's kind of, you know, inherent in a brainstorm. And put some more structure on it and put a little bit more time in it so that we could actually finish with a tangible product, something that was tested. That was kind of the earliest moment of the sprint.
You say in the book that you looked at the results of your brainstorms. And brainstorms are fun. Everybody loves it. You get together. You shout out ideas.
Yeah.
There's no bad ideas. You put a lot of post-it notes or you write a lot of things on the whiteboard. But you say that at the end of the day, you looked at the ideas that came out of them and you never used any of them.
Yeah, I mean, it was really, honestly, Leo, it was super embarrassing for me because I had been running these brainstorms for other teams at Google, and you know, we'd take a day and do these brainstorms, and you just have tons of sticky notes, and people, it is like you said, it's fun to do it, and at some point, I was running one of these, and I was kind of like training like 100 engineers how to do this sort of classic brainstorm process, and this guy stands up in the middle of it, and he's like, wait, like, what proof do you have that this works? What evidence do you have that this works? And it's actually like a really fair question. And embarrassingly, I was like, man, I've been kind of measuring whether people are satisfied with it, you know, which made me feel good, but I hadn't been measuring the ideas in any way. And there was a simple way to do that. I just went back to all these teams because I had been doing it for a few months, probably at that point, probably like a year and a half. Went back to those teams and looked at the ideas that came out and looked at what they'd been building. And it wasn't the stuff that came from the brainstorms. And so, you know, there's a lot of research about the idea that group brainstorms are not as effective as individuals working alone. But I never believed it until I tried it for myself. And I found the same thing.
So it's funny because roughly the same time, this agile methodology kind of sprung up. A lot of programmers use it. And I've been through agile a couple of times with different teams. And one of the things that come to mind for me, especially with agile, is that process tends to overwhelm progress, that there's so much. It always worries me when I see, and we as geeks, we love process.
Yeah.
And we love, no, I'm sorry, we don't love process. We love systems. We're systems people. And I see people with getting things done methodologies or tomato methodologies, spending hours putting together 43 folders. And I've done this.
Yeah.
And we get all involved in the methodology and then nothing happens. So I want to be careful. This is a wonderful methodology, but how do you make sure that it actually produces results?
Well, yeah, I'll tell you, I'll quickly tell you a story to kind of illustrate what a sprint looks like. So, not long ago, we did a sprint with Slack, so you know, the messaging software
Very nice.
Company.
Yes,
they're one of our
them.
Investments.
Yeah,
yeah, and Slack has been tremendously successful with tech companies. You know, that's where the bulk of their growth has come from, companies who are already using some kind of messaging software or something, and they're switching over to Slack. But there's this huge potential market for them with, you know, companies who are using email. They're having, you know, they're doing meetings, but maybe they're just not. They're not as into tech as the sort of core Slack audience. And so as they were continuing to grow and continuing to grow, they realized, you know, we could get a lot better at explaining the product out of the gate to people, to new customers, and helping them get started. Because if you think about that first person who uses Slack at a company, it's a big cliff to climb. You've got to figure out what Slack does. And then you've got to convince your team to try it and to, like, really to stop using email for maybe a day and just use Slack so that you can experience what it's like, which is that's a lot to ask. So they knew they had to explain it better. And in the sprint, that was what we tried to tackle, was just that first experience with the product. What's it like when you first try it out? And so the team from Slack was, you know, probably around 6-7 folks. We had, a couple product managers, a couple designers, we got engineers, marketers in the room. And what they did was to come up with a bunch of solutions, a bunch of competing solutions. So the way we do that is we have individuals work quietly and sketch in detail their own solution to the problem. So rather than a group brainstorm, it's kind of this individual quiet work. We did that. We, you know, they made the decision about which of those approaches were the best. And what rose to the top were this really, you know, sort of very ingenious idea that came from the CEO, Stuart Butterfield, who founded.
Yeah.
So he had this really intricate idea that was quite interesting for using sort of almost like a very simple AI to simulate a team using Slack. So you'd be talking to bots effectively, and using Slack even if you were just one person. And then another idea that was, you know, very detailed but basically pretty straightforward. It would just kind of bring you into Slack and step by step by step explain this part, this part, this part, and just kind of slowly bring you up to speed with Slack. And so, you know, normally what you'd have to do if you had those two ideas, you know, and you'd never have those fully fleshed out, of course, in a normal conversation. You'd just be arguing about them in the abstract. We had them fleshed out, but normally you'd have to choose. We're going to do one or the other. And so in the sprint, what we do is actually make a prototype of both. And we give one of them a fake brand name and make it look sort of realistic. But the key to all of this on building the prototype and making those decisions quickly and all of these things is that on Monday of the sprint, you start off and you say, we're going to bring in 5 customers on Friday. We're going to do 5 one-on-one interviews. We're going to start recruiting those customers now. So we're going to schedule them now. And that deadline is like there. Those people are coming in on Friday. We've got to have something to show them. And, you know, really, like, the downside is you'll be embarrassed if you don't do it. But that's just enough. Like, just knowing that we all signed up to do this and, like, these people are showing up, that ends up being this huge, you know, this huge forcing function that makes you get real, makes you make those decisions. And then that also provides the test at the end. So that's really, I think, the big difference between this and a lot of processes is that it's, you have to get real. And you know, getting real makes all the difference.
How do people take to this? Do they go kicking and screaming, or did Stuart and company go, yeah, I get it, let's do it?
Yeah, we only want people to do this, you know, in our portfolio if they're excited about it. Mm-hmm. So we really see this as
so a... tell me the pitch that you give to them.
What will typically happen is we'll be talking with a company, and we're talking with companies all the time about things that they're working on, or, you know, questions that they have, whatever. Because I'm a design partner. John Braden, my co-authors, Daniel Burka, is also a design partner, and there's another guy on our team named Michael who does design research. And for all of us, we're talking to the startups all the time and helping them hire and helping them sort of, you know, make decisions about, like, how should they make product decisions, things like that. When they come in with a big question like this, and we realize that, you know, some data would help them, and at this point, many of them have heard of a sprint, so they might come in and say, we'd like to do a sprint.
Okay.
But we're really looking for a situation where the team wants to do it.
Right.
And I think that if you frame it as, we're going to do this 5-day process together, like, that doesn't sound very appealing. But if you say, if you take a week, if you clear a week, you can design this thing, you know, a prototype of it. You can make a rough design and test it. Like, that's actually really exciting. And it's much, everybody recognizes that's much, much faster. And we usually hear back from companies afterward as, my God, that would have taken like 6 months for us to get to that if we hadn't done the sprint. So I think that word has gotten around a bit, and it's definitely not a hard sell.
We're talking to Jake Knapp. He's the author of a new book, just came out, Sprint, How to Solve Big Problems and Test New Ideas in 5 Days. The book, you probably should go to thesprintbook.com to get it, because then you can get the Sprint bonus pack, which includes a pound of Blue Bottle coffee. Blue Bottle, one of the you know, recipients of the Sprint methodology. You tell the story in here of the Blue Bottle story, which is a great story, and of course it's a Google Ventures investment. And then that thing on the right, which I see you have over your right shoulder, we're going to talk about the time timer.
The time timer
in just a little bit, and why you might want to get a time timer if you get nothing else from this book.
Yeah.
A time timer. But first, let's take a break and talk about my pills. When you get to a certain age, could be 20, and you start taking meds or you take vitamins on a regular basis, you probably realize it's time to figure out how you can dose those out every day at different times, and you get one of these pill minder boxes probably, and all sorts of things. And I got a better way. I got a full service online pharmacy that sends you this, the pill pack, that is so awesome. Go to pillpack.com/twit to find out more about it. Here's the pill pack. So what you do is you transfer your prescriptions over there. It's a regular pharmacy, so it's online. So they take most kinds of insurance, including most forms of Medicare Part D. You know, you don't pay anything extra for the pill pack. This is just how they deliver the meds to you. And by the way, the pill pack box will come if you have inhalers or ointments or creams or whatever, obviously those don't fit in this thing. They'll also come with it. It's a full-service pharmacy. But this is what's so awesome. This is the pill pack. So when you get your pill pack, it has your name on it, the date. It has images of every kind of pill you're taking. These are vitamins. It includes vitamins, over-the-counter medications, as well as prescription. If it's prescription, you'll have the dosing directions on here from your physician, even the prescription number and all of that. When you get your new pill pack, you see each pill pack is a little envelope, a little plastic envelope with the date, the day, the time, what's in it, and you just tear it off. And you now know, once you've torn that off, you don't have to say, did I take my vitamins this morning? You don't have to ever wonder. And when you travel, you just tear off the pill packs you need and you put them in your suitcase. It's amazing. This is really a better pharmacy. Medication simplified. I want you to go to pillpack.com/twit. Take a look at it. If you decide to transfer your prescriptions over, they will give you a credit worth $20 worth of vitamins and over-the-counter medications that you can use. The referral program's great, too. You refer somebody to PillPack, they'll donate $100 to RX Art, which is a nonprofit whose mission is to help children heal through visual art. I think Jake would like this. And there's no cost beyond your standard copay. Shipping is always free. It's really cool. They're staffed 24/7, so you don't have to have any of those embarrassing conversations. I love it. PillPack.com/twit. And do refer, if you have elders, your parents, family members who take medications and who have a hard time, as I do, remembering, did I take that? This is a great service. You tell them, turn them on to this. PillPack.com/twit. We're talking about how to get up and running if you've got a great idea in 5 days. It's Sprint. Jake Knapp is the author. He's a design lead at Google Ventures. He helps startups all the time, and this is the technique, one of the techniques that they use to get those startups kind of in gear and going. So the problem is you have lots, everybody has lots of good ideas. You say in the book that good ideas are scarce. I feel like good ideas are a dime a dozen. It's the execution. It's getting to market with a good idea that's so hard.
Yeah, it's true. It's really hard to go from that idea that's in your head or that you're talking about to something that, that's in the real world. And a lot of times when people have a good idea, and even when the business is starting to make some headway, it's still really hard to get it to where you want it to be.
Right.
And you've got to find something that fits people's real life. And that's kind of what design is. Design is sort of figuring out how to take an idea and make it fit humans, make it fit into their lives. But how to go from A to B, how to sort of build that bridge from the idea or the vision to the real world is very hard. And we tried to demystify it in the book.
So how do we, all right, I got a startup, the Leo startup, and I have some, I have a great idea, but where do I, so help me, let's do the methodologies.
Let's talk about PillPack. You just talked about
all right, PillPack.
I actually don't know anything about them. They're not an investment or anything.
Okay.
I was just looking at that and imagining how you might test that idea. If we rewound and imagine them thinking of that for the first time, thinking of that, we want to do something with a box and we want to, have the packages labeled nicely, really easy to understand. And would that idea be compelling enough that, people would switch to this new pharmacy? It's just kind of taking a jump to do that,
right,
taking a leap.
Right. That's the challenge for them is because there's a fairly big speed bump, which is
I'm used to going down the street to Walgreens,
right,
or whatever.
I got it all wired. I mean, it may not be the best experience in the world, but it works.
Yeah. So you can imagine them in their sprint talking about those ideas. They'd get the team together, right? So they'd figure out who's the, and maybe in that early stage, the whole team is like five people. But if it's a bigger company, if it's a bigger, set of folks, then you choose kind of a diverse team. So you want one person in the room who's a decision maker. You want one person in a room who is an expert on the customer. One person who's going to be the facilitator, who's going to kind of keep track of time. And you just want like a bunch of different skill sets, something that kind of represents your team well. And throughout the course of the week on Monday, you'd make a map of everything that you kind of know. You're just laying out there, hey, who are our potential customers and how do they find out about our product? Where are they going to discover it? And then what's going to happen as they, you know, as they sign up for the first time, as they get their first box of pills, how is that process going to work? And so that's Monday. And then on Tuesday, you'd sketch solutions to it. On Wednesday, you'd make decisions about it and make a storyboard, make a plan for your prototype. And then on Thursday, you'd build that prototype. And you can imagine for PillPack, you know, they might say, well, we can make one of those boxes. Or perhaps what they do is actually just mock up the marketing page for it. So if they say, you know, a lot of people are going to hear about this when they search for something online, or they're going to hear about it from their doctor, or they're going to hear about it from Leo. They just mock up that discovery point and maybe just the website. And maybe they compare it in the test on Friday against some other pharmacies or some other, you know, similar services. And on Friday, they show it to five of their target customers, five people who they think might be, you know, the folks who are going to adopt this first. And they make it look as realistic as possible so that when you do that test, the rest of the team can watch. And just one-on-one, you're showing it to a customer. The rest of the team watches in another room over video. You just take notes. And by the end of the day, you can see these big patterns. Even with just five people, you can start to see, okay, well, that, you know, that part worked, that part didn't, and now we know what to do next. And if you've ever started a big thing, a big complex problem, you know that's like a huge deal to have clarity about what to do.
Yeah, no kidding. I mean, that's, you know, when we designed our new website, I wish we had done that, but I just said, I'm the decider in chief, and this is what we're going to do.
Well, that's another way. I mean, that is also very effective.
Somebody needs to take charge. You actually have a decider on the team.
Yeah, and actually, that's really important. I mean, I think all too often teams make decisions by consensus, or they're not really clear on who the decider is. There's some ambiguity about who makes the decision.
Yeah, when we first started the process, there was this kind of thinking that it might be a democracy among all the stakeholders. So, and the first time we went through a process where it was, it didn't work at all. And so I just said, well, I'm the decider. So now, because I'm writing the check. So now what? Yeah. So you have to have that person.
You do. You end up with better outcomes.
But you also have to empower other members of the team as well, right?
Well, yeah. What we want to do is empower everyone by giving them a chance to have their idea on a level playing field with everyone else's idea. So a lot of times people discuss ideas, and you can imagine in our sprint with Slack, there's one idea that comes from the CEO and another idea that comes from, you know, just someone on the team. And the normal dynamic, I mean, Stuart's really cool, but like the normal dynamic of a company, if you have like the CEO and then like some team member's idea, is that everybody's going to want to just go with the team member's idea. And so even if you have, you know, this sort of bias coming in about whose ideas are best, or even if somebody's really good at making a sales pitch, whatever it is, that they're not going to get that advantage in the sprint. The sketches stand on their own. They're anonymous. And they're evaluated in silence at first, actually. So what you end up with is ideas can come from anywhere, but the ultimate decision will be made by the decision maker and informed by data at the end of the week.
That's always the Google way, isn't it? Informed by data. No guessing here. So who's on our team? You said seven people is the perfect number.
Yeah, it really depends on the company. But one thing that we found is if you had a
40 person sprint, that didn't work.
Yeah,
so
we made
good.
A lot of mistakes. I personally have made a lot of mistakes along the way. So if you get the book, you will in here have the chance to avoid any of my mistakes because I talk about them in the book.
Yeah, no, it's great.
So 40 is too many. I found that the best number is seven, actually. Yeah. So, you know, seven turns out to be, you know, enough that you have a lot of different viewpoints. You'll have people, you know, disagreeing with each other in a good way. That's a good thing. But you won't have so many that you're spending the whole time managing conversations and, you know, reviewing everybody's idea. You really keep moving quickly. So give you an idea of an example of another company, another sprint that is I tell the story of in the book. There's this company called Savioke who makes a robot, a hotel delivery robot. And so It doesn't deliver hotels. It delivers like toothbrushes and towels at hotels. And in their sprint, they've got, you know, the CEO, they've got like the chief technology officer. So she's a roboticist, you know, and they've got engineers, they've got a designer, they've got their head of marketing and their head of like business development. So it's that kind of thing where you've got some of the people who you'd expect are working on the product and would normally be in any kind of a, you know, project meeting about building something, but also people who come in with a little bit of a different angle, whether that's marketing or customer support or business development. It really depends on the project, but you want different perspectives.
We've all seen that video on YouTube of the poor coders and designers sitting there with the marketing team. And the marketing team, remember that? And the marketing team says, well, can you make that line blue? Well, no, because it's...
Yeah, I mean, I think there's a lot of this kind of, you know, sometimes almost animosity between different, you know, different job roles as companies, especially as companies grow and people don't know each other as intimately. And it's too bad because I've found that, you know, frequently as a designer, if you are given the chance to listen to an engineer, a marketer, whoever it is, who you might come in with a sort of standpoint of like, well, I'm the designer, so I should know how to do it. You know, it turns out design is just problem solving. And if you can really hear those people's ideas out and give them the tools to express those ideas clearly, it's a great chance that there's solid ideas underneath.
Here's the video. Let me just play a little bit of this because it's so funny.
Our company has a new strategic initiative to increase market penetration, maximize brand loyalty, and enhance intangible assets. In pursuit of these objectives, we've started a new project for which we require 7 red lines. I understand your company can help us in this matter.
Of course. Walter here will be the project manager. Walter, we can do this, can't we?
Yes, of course. Anderson here is our expert in all matters related to...
Poor Anderson.
We've brought him along today to share his professional opinion.
Nice to meet you. Well, you all know me. This is Justine, our company's design specialist.
Hello.
We need you to draw 7 red lines, all of them strictly perpendicular, some with green ink and some with transparent. Can you do that?
No, I'm afraid...
Let's not rush ahead.
Okay, I'll leave this to you. Look for the expert on YouTube. But that's we've all been in that meeting. And so that's what we're trying not to do.
Yeah, normal meetings can be pretty bad. I mean, you know, I think there's a spectrum of meetings, but they all kind of happen in this world of like, let's hope for the best. Let's get together.
Oh, there you go. Hope.
You know, so let's hope that we can just as humans kind of have a dialogue and that something good will come out of the end. And then if you zoom out from the meeting and you look at your day, it's just like in most companies, there's meeting, meeting, meeting. And somebody schedules a meeting and you say yes, and it's an obstacle course to actually getting anything done.
You have a lovely, by the way, the book is filled with fun little illustrations. And I am holding an uncorrected proof, so...
There's a lot of mistakes.
There's a lot of TKs, but there may not be what it looks like in the end. But can you show that? This is the typical work day.
That's real. That's
meeting, meeting, check email, work, fast lunch, meeting, meeting, check email, meeting, meeting, internet surfing, sunset. This is not what we want to do. We want to put a little work in there, a little more work in there.
Yeah, and I mean, it actually turns out you can get more done in less time.
I like that.
If you focus on one big thing.
And one of the ways you focus is, some really good tips in here. No screens, and we mentioned this earlier on, no laptops, no phones, because people get sidetracked. I know I do.
Yeah, for sure.
But is there somebody taking notes? How do you... keep track of what you do?
We take notes as we go. On the first day, we're taking notes just on sticky notes. And we have a little technique for that that we didn't come up with, but it turns out to be a very good technique that we talk about in the book. And so we take some notes like that. We're taking notes on the whiteboard as we go. So
yeah, you say whiteboards are a great tool.
Whiteboards are really great. Yeah, and actually some amazing things that happen when you put a group of people in a room for a week and you have the same whiteboards up there, and you know, when you make note of something, it stays up there, because all of a sudden your spatial memory for where information is gets engaged and you don't have to hold everything in your short-term memory. So yeah, there's a map, and we have a map like that up on
this the Savvy Oak story of how they got.
Yeah. So this shows all the different, you know, the different sort of, people involved in the delivery, the people who might encounter sort of the robot. And when you have that up on the wall, then you don't have to do quite so much verbal discussion around every single point or every single question. You know, everybody's talking about the same problem and talking about it in the same way. And so that's important. And actually, it sounds, you know, sort of maybe archaic, but notes on paper, and especially notes on whiteboards, are a lot more effective than any sort of complex, you know, webs, annotation right. software or anything you might use.
Well, and you quote Tim Brown of IDEO, the CEO of IDEO, saying that the problem is when you do it on a computer and PowerPoint or wherever, it's hidden away.
Yeah.
When it's up there on the wall, it's present and visible for everybody during the entire time. It's not hidden away.
Yeah.
I love idea paint. I might want to get some idea paint. You paint the walls with this paint that makes it all a whiteboard.
Yeah, that stuff is good. As long as your walls are smooth, it's really good.
Is that what's on your wall? I see you have dry erase markers on the wall.
We have something fancy here. I think it's kind of a wall of dry erase board, but idea paint is good. The only other caution with idea paint is to paint all the walls, because I've been in a lot of startups where, like, somebody continued their diagram onto the adjacent white wall. It's there now forever. So
that's great. So that wall to your right, that's all whiteboard there.
Yeah.
This one, you go.
We're serious about whiteboards at GV. We have a lot of whiteboards around.
That's nice. You also, let's talk about the time timer, because that's also an important tool.
Time timer is amazing. Yeah.
You have one over your right shoulder.
I do.
There.
I should, you know what? I'm going to put the headphones down and grab
it. Show us the time timer. Give us a little demo. We're talking with Jake Knapp. He's the author of a book, Sprint, How to Solve Big Problems and Test New Ideas in Just 5 Days. It just came out. It's on Amazon. And as I mentioned earlier, it's on audible.com. And you know, even though we've been kind of wandering around with the conversation, it's a very like step by step, day one, day two, day three. It's a real great prescription for how to do this, along with a lot of examples, including Fitstar, where Tony, look at the post-it notes there.
Okay, but that should never. That's
wrong. That's a failure.
That's craziness. The first problem actually is multicolored sticky notes, I think, just lead to some cognitive load. You know, you're like, is the green one, like, what does that mean? And what's the purple ones mean? So we're just, you know,
all
just keep it simple. Just keep it simple. But yeah, but let me, I'll bore you briefly with the time timer. Actually, the time timer is amazing. So this is the time timer.
It's a great story too.
It is.
Talk about a good startup story.
Oh yeah, it is. I've had the chance to meet Jan, who's the inventor behind the time timer and the CEO of time timer. And she created this clock to teach her daughter about time. Her daughter was really interested in knowing how long it was. Just when her daughter was 4 years old, you know, was just asking her over and over again, how long is it? How long is it? And Jan was like, well, I'm going to explain it to her one way or another. And she bought different clocks. She tried them out. She tried, you know, the sand timers, you know, uh-huh. just everything she could find. And finally, she was like, you know, I'm just going to try to make something. And she prototyped it with a paper plate. So the way this works is that you kind of just slide this out, and then it's a, you
we're
going to
spend 15 minutes on this subject.
Spend 15 minutes on this, and then it'll just slowly just kind of tick down, you know, on its own. And when it gets to the top, it beeps, and I have it turned off right now because it beeps a little loud. So, but that's just, you know, that's the idea. And what happens is you set this, and then you set it down, and everybody can see how much time we have for this, you know, for this topic. And that's,
I got to get one of those.
Yeah. It's fantastic. I mean, it's great. It is great for kids as original.
Yeah, but it's designed. Or the kids who work in your office.
Exactly. I mean, or me, you know, I'll be sitting down to write and I'll just like set this thing and I'll be like, oh yeah, time's elapsing. You
yeah.
Well, reading the news or whatever, I should get back to it.
Yeah. It's get it for me. Cool. Yeah. That's so, I guess because you're a designer, there's a lot of visual help here. Is that, does that only work with visual thinkers, or does it work for everybody?
I think it works for everybody. And it's not, you know, I think you'll find in the, although the book has a lot of illustrations, that most of the things we're asking you to do are actually pretty simple and don't require sort of any art skills or even interest in art. It's really a lot of writing words, you know, which we all can do, and drawing rectangles occasionally. Rectangles and arrows are the fanciest that you'll be asked to do. Maybe a stick figure, if you're sort of diagramming people moving through somewhere in your sketch. But the tools are simple, and we keep things on paper and on the whiteboard, and we make a lot of these things physical just because fancy software is not always the answer. Sometimes it's just a really simple approach to getting things out and into the physical world, and having, you know, some very simple organized discussions is all it takes, and doesn't take a super, super complex process, anything really amazing on the software side or anything. You can just have a good conversation, make a decision, build a prototype, test it, and it's pretty practical.
I need a time timer for this show because, as usual, we just begun and we're almost out of time. So a good way to get a time timer is to go to the website thesprintbook.com and look at the pack, because if you buy the book, you can get a 25% off a time timer, and I love the blue bottle. You get some blue bottle coffee.
I mean, you can't go wrong with that deal. You could probably get the book for less than, you know, you'll save on the coffee. And the there's actually a sprint edition of the time timer. The color will match the color of the time timer will match the color of the book.
Oh, nice.
For you, if you really want to color coordinate. So just throwing that out there.
There's also really great, I mean, you're giving away a lot of stuff. There's really great information on the website about tools. There's a PDF checklist that you can use, a supply shopping list, so you can get the things we've been talking about, like the yellow sticky notes. Lots of, and software tools, too, that you can use. Lots of really great information in here. Let's take a break. And you know what I really owe everybody is just a quick rundown of the 5 days, so you just get an idea of what each day entails, because you're just going to have to read the book to get the full methodology. Sprint. Jake Knapp is our guest. We'll have more in just a bit. Our show today brought to you by DigitalOcean. Talk about a perfect tool for people who are trying to make a prototype of a great product. I love DigitalOcean. DigitalOcean is cloud computing. It's really for anybody. I mean, it says for developers, but frankly, you can set up a WordPress site in like a minute and have it running, and it's very affordable, as little as $5 a month. If you're a developer, you know, it's nice to have, they call them droplets. It's nice to have a place, a public place on the web where you can prototype. First, you choose which operating system you want: Ubuntu, FreeBSD, Fedora, Debian, CoreOS, CentOS. Let's go with a plain old Ubuntu. Then you choose your size, as I said, as little as $5 a month and $0.007 an hour. That's like 0.7 cents an hour. You can choose where your data center is. I really like this for geographical use. And then if you want, you can, you know, set up a VPN. You can have backups built. There's all sorts of things, including, and I really love this, SSH key login, which makes it really much more secure. It already has my SSH keys, as you can see here from my iMac. So that makes it very fast. So let's provision. Are you ready? We're going to provision our droplet while I'm talking to you about DigitalOcean. Before I'm done, we'll have a server up and running. That's how fast it is. You know why? It's SSDs. 600,000 developers use it. Robert uses it. I use it. Randall Schwartz uses it. Aaron Newcomb, you see it's provisioning. This is kind of fun. I love doing this. If you've ever set up a server anywhere else, provisioning usually takes a day. You know, you got to call them. And blah, 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 blah. You can also, there's plenty of one clicks. I didn't even show you this, like a Drupal, Docker, Node.js, WordPress. So you can quickly build in the re-unrails the infrastructure you want. You got root access, of course, to your servers. It's dedicated. It's highly scalable. You can power it up and power it down. Oh, it's done. I didn't get to finish the copy. It's done. And then it says, go change the world. Isn't that awesome? And I can log right into it with SSH, and I am ready to go. This is a fabulous, fabulous thing. DigitalOcean.com. No wonder they are the fastest growing cloud service out there. incredibly affordable, straightforward pricing. Hourly pricing available too, less than a penny an hour. But here's the deal. We're going to get you started today. Deploy your own SSD-based cloud server free. Go to DigitalOcean.com, create an account. Once you confirm your email and account information, go to the billing section and use the offer code Triangulation, $10 credit. Boom. That's 2 months. DigitalOcean.com. I can't wait to see what you're working on. DigitalOcean.com, offer code Triangulation. I use it all the time. You know, when I'm learning Clojure or learning, you know, I need servers, public servers that I can access so that I could try these web design tools, React or whatever. And it's so easy. DigitalOcean.com. Get your $10 credit when you use the offer code Triangulation. Set up the account and then go into the billing section. Use that offer code. We're talking, this is a great time to be an entrepreneur, to have an idea. It has never been easier to get out there and with tools like this, just do it. And what's nice is there are people who have led the way, who have been there before you, like Jake Knapp, who have very kindly, I think, that's one of the spirits of this, which I love, given away the knowledge that they've gleaned over the years. This book helps you do it. Solve, test, and prototype in just 5 days. So we got our team. I got to set my timer. We got our team. We got our tools. We got a room. First thing you do is set a goal. And I love this. You quote the Apollo 13 crisis. Houston, we got a problem. You talk about how they began to solve the problem. Gene Kranz, who's the flight director, walks into the room and draws the solution, says, this is it. They're here. This is the Earth. How do we get them back?
Yeah, and I don't know. I don't know how well, you know, the movie
maps the movie.
To real life. In the movie, that's what he does.
Yeah.
And but that idea of having that map of throughout the whole crisis, you know, or in this case, the whole sprint, is super useful. Because you know, everyone's talking about the same thing. And in Apollo 13, they're saying, okay, we got them to here, and we remember we still have to get them to Earth. But it just makes everyone on the same. You know, page.
We showed Savvy Oak's map, Blue Bottle Coffee map. You have to say, here's what we're trying to do. This is Flatiron Health. Actually, if you go back one, there's a text. Yeah, long-term, that's Blue Bottles. Let's go back even more to the long-term goal. More patients enrolled in trials. I guess it's not on the PDF, but in the book, it talks about the long-term goal, more patients enrolled in trials, and the questions for this sprint, can we find matches fast enough? Will clinics change the workflow to do this? So you actually articulate, it doesn't have to be a drawing.
Yeah. Well, that's an example of one with Flatiron where it's super complicated. This is a company who's trying to organize the world's cancer data so that they can find better treatment matches for patients. And the project that they were starting on the sprint, this big, huge, you know, like multi-year project to better match patients with clinical trials. It's really intricate. It's really complex, but you can make a simple high-level map that helps you just hang all of the rest of your thinking on it.
And I should point out, this doesn't have to just be startups. I'm on nonprofit boards. This comes up all the time. How do we do this? This would be a great retreat process to solve this to solve these problems.
Yeah, and then you're sure that everyone's talking about the same customer. Everyone's talking about the same part in the process. And so we'll spend a lot of the day on Monday then having conversations with different people on the team. So basically interviewing them one at a time. Tell us what you know about it and tell us if we should fix the map anywhere.
Yep.
And so once you've got that goal and you've listed some key questions that you want to answer in the sprint, then you're just making that map for the whole day, which, you know, it might sound like a long time to do that, but what you're doing also is you're sharing all of the information that everyone has, and usually that never happens at the same time. So by the end of the day on Monday, everybody's got the same stuff all booted up in their head.
Now, Tuesday comes around.
Tuesday comes around, and everybody's probably itching to start solving the problem because you didn't do that yet. You didn't begin that yet. And so on Tuesday, the big thing we do is sketch. We do a few steps before we start sketching so that anyone can sketch without you know, without being intimidated by kind of the blank sheet of paper, or, you know, I'm not a person who draws, any feeling like that, we basically get around it by just going step by step by step. Here's how you get to the point where you're sketching. And by the way, the sketches that you do are just, they're just words and rectangles.
You don't have to be an artist. Detail.
Yeah, yeah. And you have lots of time. You have lots of time to really detail it out. So we make these storyboards by the end of the day that have a detailed solution from each person. And what we're trying to do on Tuesday, you know, is to take the tools that designers have, as you know, designers know how to express things visually. And that often means that when a problem comes along, a team will look to the designer and say, okay, we just solve it and figure out how it should be done.
Right.
And that misses a lot of potential, you know, potential solutions from the rest of the team. So we want to give those tools to everyone on Tuesday. And so by the end of the day, we'll have, you know, a lot of times like 10, 12 competing solutions that we can choose from.
And then?
And then on Wednesday morning, you put all those up on the wall. And we do a structured critique of the sketches. So you're going to go through on Wednesday and do what we call a sticky decision. And yeah, you can see the steps right here. So we hang them up on the wall. We do a heat map. So this is just a silent review where people are just putting dots by parts of things that they like. All of the sketches are anonymous. So at this point, you don't know whose is whose. And then when we go around and talk about them, we actually use that time timer. We time the conversation and we don't let the creator talk about it until the end. So if you can, you know, imagine that, I talked about that sprint with Savvy Oak, where we're looking at different, in this case, they wanted to find out if it was a good idea to give their robot a personality. And so we're looking at all these sketches with different ideas for personality that the robot could have. What kind of face might it have? What kind of, you know, what kind of things might it do? How should it move? How should it make sounds? What should it do? And we're just one at a time talking about each sketch, talking about it for 3 minutes. Each person just says, I like this part, I like this part, I don't like that part. We make note of each of those things. At the end, we say, okay, whoever drew this, tell us if we missed anything. And for instance, one of the ideas that came up was having the robot do a dance. And people were worried that the robot doing the dance would be, you know, kind of like would it run over people's feet? This is kind of a heavy robot. And at the end, you know, the creator said, the person who sketched that said, well, it could just pivot. Like maybe it would just pivot in place and not, you know, roll over anybody's foot. So that's what happens in the morning. And then what at the end of that review, you've got the decision maker just making the call. This is the one or this is the two or three ideas that we're going to test. And that sets you up for building the prototype on Thursday.
Thursday we start. We actually, some people will say, "Oh, now we're starting to do some work." But actually, I think Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday are fun. They're the really creative time, aren't they?
They are, and they set you up to be able to prototype super fast on Thursday because you don't have to wonder what should happen here. The sketches are really detailed, so they've got all the detail, and you don't have to wonder should I make this or that. You know, all the decisions have been made on Wednesday, and you know, as I mean, you were just talking about DigitalOcean, talking about how hard it used to be to set up servers. I mean, everything.
Trivial.
Yeah, there's the prototyping tools that exist today are remarkable. And so, if you're building software, there are some fantastic tools you can use to very rapidly, easily within a day, you can make something look not only look like a real, you know, iPhone app, but look like it's in the App Store. You can take screenshots of the App Store and modify them and make it look like it's really there. There's all kinds of things you can do. If you're building hardware, you probably have, you know, access to things like 3D printers. You know, there's just a ton of tools that make things remarkably easy and fast to build.
I love it because you talk about those Western towns where you walk down the street, you know, it's a movie set and it looks like you're in a town, but then if you look behind the facade, there's no building there. It's just a front.
Yeah.
You say, build a facade. It's okay.
Build a facade. Yeah. That's the big idea, is that if you think about the plumbing of the building and you think about the architecture of the building, which is the kind of conversations we want to have as, you know, as engineers and as people who for, you know, are 99% of the time at work, we're building the finished product. If you just build the front of it, you can skip a lot of hard work, and you can learn from the facade. You can show people the facade. It'll feel like they're using the product through one very narrow moment of maybe 5 or 10 minutes on Friday when you test it. But that's all you need to start to learn.
And that's what the first few days have done, is they've given you a clear thing that you want to test, so that you can make sure that it's not, you don't have to test everything. You're testing a particular idea, a particular set of problems, and so the facade can just be addressed directly to those.
Yeah.
They don't have to cover every option.
Exactly. And one of the things we really like about it, as investors, we want our companies to be able to take risks. We want them to try those bolder ideas. And in the sprint, you can try two ideas head-to-head. One really risky in one direction, one that goes in another direction. You don't have to water them down and merge them. You test them. Build both. You get to see for yourself what would they look like if they were finished. If we fast forwarded, what would we get?
And isn't necessarily programming. I mean, you could do that in Keynote even. I mean, it depends.
Keynote is actually what we use most of the time.
Really?
To mock them up, because Keynote you can get realistic really fast, but you won't try to make it perfect because it's not a perfect design tool, and it's a great way to build a prototype.
And by the way, we're giving you the kind of the step-by-step, but the book is peppered with examples from like Slack. I mean, from companies you know and love and use, and it's really great behind-the-scenes stuff too. I mean, that's really fun. All the Slack insight I got from here was great. The Slack story.
Yeah, we get the chance to work with some pretty unusual companies and in all kinds of different industries, and we thought it would be. It'd be helpful in the book to tell some of those stories.
Great.
You can see what a sprint looks like for a coffee company, for Slack, for a healthcare company.
So finally, we've got the prototype, and Friday, that's when we show people and we watch. And you say just 5 people. You don't need a lot. It's not a big, giant focus group. And you're just kind of, you have questions that you want to answer about how people react or interact with your prototype.
Yeah, and focus group is a good thing to talk about, because it's not a focus group, and it's the idea with a focus group is usually that you get a group of people in the room together, and then that's definitely something you should be skeptical of, because you have group dynamics. You have people like loud people talking too much, quiet people not talking enough, and people influencing each other. We do a one-on-one interview. So in the sprint, you're just going to talk one-on-one with your customers. One person from the team interviews, shows this customer the prototype, and watches what they do. And this is usually actually a target customer, probably somebody who's not familiar with your product at all. And as they look at each prototype, meanwhile, the rest of the team is in another room watching over video. And we just use GoToMeeting or something simple to stream the video and taking notes. And so there's some pretty good research behind using the number 5 for this kind of interview, that 5 people will show you 85% of what you'd ever learn if you kept doing studies.
Interesting.
And so you get these big obvious patterns, things that clearly work well, and also things that clearly like people are tripping up on. You can see that after 5 people. And it doesn't replace that large scale quantitative data that you might get later on, but it's something that you can get like immediately. You can get it literally like the same week. You walk out of the door on Friday afternoon and you're like, you've got clarity about what to do. And that's just crazy. If the fastest thing that you launch to a million people or whatever, you're not going to know why people are clicking or not clicking, even when you get that large scale data. But when you show people one-on-one, you hear them talk, you see what happens, you see how they react. It's incredibly powerful when you're in those early stages of a big idea.
You've been doing sprints for some time. You started writing about it in public about 3 or 4 years ago.
Yeah.
People have adopted it. You say in the book that the very first sprint was Orville and Wilbur Wright.
Yeah. I don't know how they got a hold of
a blog. Time travelers. Yeah. 5 days from now, we're going to fly. How do we get there? That's an awesome, awesome idea. But of course, it's been used by everybody from McKinsey and Wieden and Kennedy. Google used it with the city of San Francisco to help people find affordable housing, Airbnb, Facebook, schools too. I love it that a teacher teaching a math teacher teaching probability in high school used this, he created a block week, which is a great idea. Actually, that was at Columbia, wasn't it? But the high school math teachers used it to teach about probability in Seattle.
Yeah, I heard a couple weeks ago from a high school English teacher who was using it to get students, you know, trying out different ideas. They were writing about Hamlet and to get them to, you know, consider different approaches before committing to one, you know, topic for their essay.
And actually, in a way, those kids are learning more than about Hamlet. They're learning about a methodology for getting things done, for making a difference in the world. And I think that's great. They're learning.
Yeah, and it's, you know, at its core, that's what it is. It's just a way to approach a problem and come up with solutions and pick from them. That tries to take out some of the bad things that can happen when we just follow the path of least resistance, when we just talk or when we just sort of, you know, noodle around and try to come up with a strategy on the fly. It's helpful sometimes to have a process because then you don't have to think about the process. You can just think about solving the problem, you know, and that turns out to be really powerful.
Definitely worth a read, but I would say start at thesprintbook.com. There's lots of additional information in there, tools, step-by-steps, checklists, but I think you really want to read the book, not just because it's a great methodology, but because it's a really fun read, and there's some great anecdotes in there. From the history of Sprint, Jake Knapp, our guest. He's with Google Ventures. His co-authors, John Zaratsky, Braden Kowitz, helped create this methodology that's been used to great effect with many companies that you know. They talk about Fitstar, by the way. We're big fans of Fitstar.
A lot of sprints with Fitstar, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Hey, it's really great to talk to you, Jake. I wish you success with the book. I think this needs to get out to more people. This is a really great tool that people can use in a lot of contexts.
Awesome. Well, thank you for having me on. And people, check it out. Let me know what you think. Send me a tweet.
On the Twitter, at Jake K. And, of course, the book is available not only in bookstores and Audible and Amazon, but also in Audible and audiobook form, as I mentioned at the beginning of the show. Thank you, Jake.
Thanks a lot.
Take care. See you, Leo. We do Triangulation every Monday, 11 a.m. Pacific, 2 p.m. Eastern Time, 1800 UTC. Yes, our clocks have jumped forward. UTC didn't move, so we are now at 1800 UTC. You figure it out for your own time zone. I know I can't. This week, by the way, it's going to be a little different if you like to watch Triangulation live. Of course, Apple has its big event at exactly the same time. So when you tune in Triangulation next week, you won't see the show live. You'll be seeing our coverage of Apple's, I guess we'll call it the Spring 2016 event. However, we do have a Triangulation in the can that we did some weeks ago that's awesome with the founder and inventor of Sphero. We'll talk about Sphero, the BB-8, how that came about, his amazing meeting with Lucas, and a whole lot more. That is next week on Triangulation, but you can't watch it live. You'll have to download it. If you're a subscriber, you'll get it automatically. We have audio and video at twit.tv/TRI, but every podcast client, podcatcher, will just search for Triangulation or Twit, and you'll find all of our shows. And, of course, there's Twit apps on every platform, and we didn't do those. I thank the fans, the great fans and developers who've written Twit apps for Roku and Apple TV. There's 5 different Apple TV apps. Pick the one you like the best. iOS, Android, Windows Phone, Windows, Mac, everywhere. Find the app, subscribe. But this is one show you really don't want to miss. Every week, something great. Thanks for joining us. We'll see you next time on Triangulation. Bye-bye. Thank you, Jake. There they are, Orville and Wilbur, completing their 5-day sprint.
Yeah, that's Friday.
That's Friday. Friday. Hey, that's really fun. Thank you.